شاگرد همایی در کنگره آمریکا در آستانه نوروز. فراخوان به بازگشت فوری مجاهدین به اشرف. 15 مارس 2013، 25 اسفند 1391. ایلیانا روزلهتینن، رئیس زیر کمیته خاورمیانه. کوین بریدی، نماینده ارشد در کمیته راه حل‌ها، معاون رهبری اکثریت کنگره. شیلا جکسون لی، عضو کمیته قضایی، عضو ارشد کمیته امنیت ملی. رندی وبر، عضو کمیته خارجی. برت شرمن، نایب رئیس زیر کمیته تروریسم. فورتن بری، عضو کمیته بودجه. جان کارتر، عضو کمیته بودجه. تری ریدل، عضو کمیته خارجی. ترنت فرانکس، عضو ارشد کمیته قوای مسلح، عضو کمیته قضایی. استیو استاکمن، عضو کمیته خارجی. کرن بس، عضو کمیته خارجی. سرهنگ وسلی مارتین، فرمانده حفاظت اشرف. سرهنگ مک گلاسکی، فرمانده حفاظت اشرف. پروفسور آلن گرسون، مشاور پیشین هیئت آمریکا در ملل متحد.
Well, thank you so much. I did not come here to speak, but simply to support your efforts to bring about democratic change in Iran. And I had the opportunity this fall to have coffee in Houston with Ali Sujani to be able to visit about these issues, and it really gave me, really opened my eyes both to the challenges and to the opportunities here. Your efforts are so tireless, and I believe it's paying off in a major way as more and more members get engaged. And you can count me among those who are supporting Congressman Poe in his legislation to ensure the full protection of the residents of Camp Liberty. So I want to thank you so much for having me.
Good morning. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. This is indeed a bittersweet moment. It is a sweet moment because it is the beginning of the new year, but it is also a bitter moment, although we try not to allow the bitterness to overshadow the sweetness. Still, we have to acknowledge the bitterness of the conditions, of the inhumane conditions that prevail at Camp Liberty, and the realization that this resettlement may indeed be a cruel hoax. As some of you know, for many years I was a lawyer that represented victims of state-sponsored terrorism. And it is ironic that today we see a situation that prevailed in Camp Liberty that raises, in my judgment, the specter as to whether this was simply the act of one terrorist group, a Hezbollah group, or whether there was state guidance, cooperation, and even sponsorship. Now, these are heavy charges, but facts are facts. We know what happened prior to the attack. You have seen the pictures. At Camp Liberty, just these bunkers, bunks, which, as General Jones said, leave people in conditions that are worse than those that we accord to inmates of Al-Qaeda at Guantanamo. And we know that prior to the attack, we know because it's a fact, that there were 17,500 concrete walls. This acted as a barrier to provide protection against rocket attacks. Now, what happened? They were removed by the government. Now, sometimes when things are removed, you ask, well, there must be a good reason. There's a shortage of supplies. Somebody else needed immediate protection. But nothing like that occurred. There's no shortage of these firewalls, of these concrete T-walls. There's an abundance all over Iraq. Why were they removed? How can we not ask that question? And if you ask that question, it leads you ineluctably to raise the question of complicity by a government. But we must have an answer, because what happened at Camp Liberty, by any definition, was not only murder, it was mass murder. It was not only mass murder, but it was mass murder which other experts that are here today, including Colonel Martin, who know this camp very well, will explain in detail as to why an attack of this kind could not have occurred, or it's highly unlikely that it could have occurred, without the blessings, cooperation, and knowledge of the government's military forces. So that's an important question that we need an answer to, because we need to know who we are dealing with when we talk about the current government of Iraq. Well, the solution to the problem of Camp Liberty is the solution that anybody goes when one goes to a doctor. The first thing that you want is a proper diagnosis. He has to be able to tell you, do you have a rash? Do you have some cancer that's metastasizing? You can't do anything else unless the diagnosis is correct. So we have to be able to diagnose what is happening at Camp Liberty. We have to reach certain conclusions as to whether or not this is simply a fluke, or whether this is really part of a larger plan to take these people, deprive them of their own humanity, to kill them at will, and by creating a situation where there is indifference on the part of the United States, because the U.S. remains the leader, that this can serve as a green light for the Iraqis, in combination with the Iranians, to allow Hezbollah or anybody else to do whatever they want. So we have to diagnose the problem and then figure out what we can do next. Now, if you diagnose the problem as one in which we have allowed ourselves to be victims to a hoax, that yes, you can move from Camp Ashraf because this will serve as the way station to being resettled, only to realize that what you're getting into is a cell, a big prison cell. That's a hoax. So the first thing you need to do is to know who put you there, did they lie to you deliberately, and get out. Because you're not going to be in a camp where people have not only failed to provide you with the basics of refugee life. You know, if you take a look at the camps that the United Nations sets up, they have certain standards in terms of sewage and everything else. Those simple standards don't apply here. As General Jones said, the conditions at Camp Liberty are worse than the conditions that the United States accords to the very worst offenders imaginable, the people that we suspect of being Al-Qaeda operatives. So if that's all true, you know that you cannot rely on Iraq, and you know that you cannot stay in that camp because you are completely vulnerable. So you have to say, what can be done immediately? And therefore, Congress has thought of two elements that are in this draft resolution that has been sponsored. One involves taking people out of danger, getting them away from a place where they can be shot without any protection, without any room to maneuver, and moving them back to what is still an empty camp, Camp Ashraf. Thank you.
Good morning, members of Congress, congressional staff, diplomatic corps, and especially my friends in Liberty and Ashraf and the family that's represented here. I stand before you, a former soldier and concerned citizen. Since turning over responsibility for the protection of the people of Ashraf to the government of Iraq in January of 2009, I have not had a restful night of sleep, as have the residents of Ashraf and Liberty. For I was the commander of that joint interagency task force that actually did turn them over to the Iraqi government after those assurances that they would, the people of Ashraf would be protected. As most of you know, we granted those people of Ashraf protected person status as the U.S. forces came into Iraq. That protection we gave to them was unconditional. Despite the assurances and memorandums of understanding by the Iraqi government to continue to protect the people of Ashraf, they have not. The people of Ashraf and Liberty have been killed by Iraqi soldiers, and they have been killed in rocket attacks while they're at Liberty. In the last couple of years, the Iraqi government, with the assistance of the U.S. and the UNHCR, convinced the people of Ashraf and Liberty to move to this new location. Again, there were assurances from the Iraqi government. The purpose of the move was to facilitate the relocation of the people out of Iraq. This has not happened, and I see no action moving in that direction. Before the world will step forward to help us with this relocation, the United States must start accepting the residents of Liberty. They can be given political asylum. The UNHCR is the world body responsible to ensure the MEC are safe from harm once we turned over the responsibility to the Iraqis. We had to have a watchdog agency. We were assured that the UNHCR would make sure that protection happened. Martin Kobler is the man that is primarily responsible for the protection of the MEC in Iraq. And he is not doing his job from a personal standpoint, from what I've seen. And he should be replaced, because we need someone in there that truly represents the need for human kindness, protection of people. I have seen refugee camps. They are not of any standard. What they have in Iraq right now is worse than anything I've ever seen. Number three, if it were up to me, I would send all the residents of Liberty back to Ashraf until the relocation plan can be implemented and they are moved out to other countries. Four, as a minimum, the residents, the Iraqis need to immediately reinstall the T-walls. And this is an issue that I have lived with. I have been under rocket attack many times in Iraq, and I saw many people die. And many people died because the buildings they were in were not separated by T-walls. Once T-walls came in, it minimized the amount of casualties we had. As I've said before, I consider myself a resident of Ashraf. I consider them my friends and my family. I will not rest comfortably in bed at night until I see these people safe again. I thank you and God bless you.
Ladies and gentlemen, I thank you. To my brothers and sisters at Ashraf and Liberty, we continue the fight and we will continue the fight. I had developed, when I was the anti-terrorism officer, an assessment process. I have used that process this week, and I have developed a force protection assessment of Camp Liberty. All members of the media, all congressional staffers, and I've been giving them to the congressional representatives as they've been coming in, please see me, and I will be glad to share this detailed force protection assessment of Camp Liberty with you. And it will give us a chance to thoroughly analyze and go over exactly what happened, despite what U.S. State Department, despite what U.N. Ambassador Herr Kobler has stated, despite what German Ambassador Frau Kobler has stated. This gets straight to the facts. A good friend, Mr. Bumidra, who was on Kobler's staff, has now revealed Kobler hid photographs. He knew the conditions. He misstated it to the United Nations. He misstated it to the United States. He misstated it to the world, except the Iranian and the Iraqi governments. Kobler, in all honesty, is an accessory to a crime, and he needs also to be investigated as to what was his motivation. Interestingly, his wife, Frau Britta Wagner, has now been made ambassador from Germany, and it becomes quite obvious the goal there is to build business relationships between Germany and Iraq and Iran. Every time something happens bad at Camp Liberty, Kobler finds a way to spin it and to turn it around. Even the rocket attack, he initially tried to blame as a mortar that had already been in the ground exploded. Well, that didn't work. I made it quite clear in a conference call with State Department, militias do not drive around Iraq with 100 Katyusha rockets in their vehicles. They do not drive around with launching platforms. This was a very precise, coordinated attack. This attack of this precision, this capability, with this much equipment, can only come from one organization, and that is the Codes Force. It was a joint operation. The Codes Force, working with Maliki's army, brought the rockets in, and I made an assessment then, and when I talked to my friends directly inside Camp Liberty last weekend on the phone, it confirmed. Those rockets were launched on the north, came in from the northwest. Long before I became a military police officer, I started out the Army as an artillery private. I know how to call in artillery, I know how to call in direct fire. And I could see all the signs were there. Somebody was on Signal Hill watching the rockets hit inside Camp Liberty. Those rockets, the very first one, immediately started achieving kills. For 15 minutes, those rockets were launched. Terrorists fire one or two rockets and they leave. There is another technology we had in Iraq, and like all technologies and all equipment we were using to fight terrorism, we left it for the Iraqis. Whenever a rocket was launched, we would know before the rocket landed exactly where it was launched from, and we would send our attack helicopters to intercept. The Iraqi government knew exactly where those rockets came from, and the fact that they lasted for 15 minutes, the fact that they had such devastating effects, makes it quite clear this was an Iraqi government operation working with the Codes Force. Now, this organization, Iraqi Hezbollah, stepped up afterwards and said, oh, we did it. It's a front organization. Now, the Koblers immediately embraced that front organization and started saying, oh, yes, this organization did it. One of the arguments we've had, and you have a lot of good American friends that speak in your defense and fight hard for you, too. Former FBI Director Louis Freeh, former Attorney General Michael Mukasey, and I had a conversation with State Department, and we told them, where is the attack? And you cannot trust, and we cannot trust the Iraqi government to do it. And the email expression that I used was, trust in Maliki to investigate this attack is like expecting John Gotti, the New York City mobster, to investigate the murder of Big Pauly when Gotti decided he's taken over the mafia, and you'll get the same result. And that's exactly what it is. But the other thing I think we all realize, it's now been over a month, and there is no investigation. Nothing has been written, not a single paper, not a single document. In all honesty, this is the first document that investigated the facts. There will be none. There was no investigation in 2009. There was no investigation in 2011. Why? Because Maliki, and I made this quote before, Maliki does not investigate Maliki, and yet we have the struggle for humanity going on right now inside the Middle East. And what's going on inside the Middle East and going on inside Camp Liberty affects a lot of people well beyond. Here we have 3,200, counting the 100 at Ashraf, soldiers for democracy, giving it all, giving everything they can. Due to the behavior of the husband and wife Kobler team and the U.S. State Department, the risk of another attack is very high. This risk evaluation is even validated by the Koblers and State Department's Baghdad embassy representative, who have continually declined to enter Camp Liberty since the rocket attack. Their reason of refusal is always the same. Camp Liberty is too dangerous to enter. This leaves the residents with one question. If the camp is too dangerous for UN and US State Department personnel to enter, then why should we be forced to stay here inside Camp Liberty? Our friends at Camp Liberty have a very, very valid point. The overwhelming desire of the residents of Liberty is now to return to Camp Ashraf. Despite other hazards, Ashraf has proven itself to be reasonably safe from rocket attacks. Between 1986 and 2009, Ashraf endured 21 rocket attacks. During those 23 years, only one resident died from those rocket attacks. Colonel Sadiq, he has stripped 17,500 T-walls away, as my friend, true friend, Colonel McCloskey has mentioned. Those T-walls make a big difference. He has set up a stronger killing field, and Alan pointed it out correctly. This is premeditation. This is preparing the field for another rocket attack. Sadiq's latest action in removing the T-walls installed by the Americans will ensure future rockets attack achieve maximum deaths and injuries. The denial of helmets and vests ensure maximum head and upper torso injuries. This includes injuries from shrapnel, but also from residents being tossed around during the explosions. Sadiq's refusing to allow the residents to have sandbags further increases their risk. Cement barriers do not absorb the energy of blasts, only deflects. It's time for us to stand up to them now. Both the Koblers need to go, and I'll read this in its entirety. Ban Ki-moon's Ban Ki-moon's exposed desire to have a representative working with al-Maliki rather than no representative at all is a very Machiavellian concept. The fact that Germany is trying to build trade relationship with Iran and Iraq does not justify selling out humanity. Chancellor Angela Merkel, above all other national leaders, should understand the wrongs of selling out human life in favor of national prosperity. If she doesn't, then she has lost touch with her own nation's history in the past century. And I submit, for what they have done as part of this investigation that I am recommended being done on the Koblers, they should also add an investigation for assisting and taking actions that resulted and helped support the murder of innocent people. They helped set the stage. Martin Kobler didn't fire the rockets. Brother Wagner didn't fire the rockets, but they helped make the environment. And now we look at our friend Hamid over here. He's German. And his problems were developed immediately after the rocket attack. And attempts were made to get him sent back to Germany. Britta Wagner, Frau Kobler, could have easily ordered her staff, give him his passport, get him up to Germany, give him the surgery he needs. Instead, he was left for a month to die. If a comprehensive resettlement cannot be quickly achieved, then the residents need to be returned to Ashraf under the protection of United Nations forces. And ladies and gentlemen, I appreciate your allowing me to be part of this fight. We were together in a field of combat. We've been together for the past several years. We're going to be together always. Thank you.
Well, thank you all for being here, and we appreciate y'all's efforts. I am a member of the Foreign Affairs Committee, and I want you all to know, that's Texas speak for y'all plural, I want you all to know that we stand strong and united with y'all. It is time for a change in Iran. It is time for the United States of America and for the United Nations to stand up and say to the tyrants in Iran, enough is enough. That we want liberty, we want freedom, we want democracy. Too much blood has been shed. There's been too much death and destruction at the government's hands, from the government. And that's an atrocity, that is a human rights violation that you all have taken the lead on standing against and fighting against, making the world aware of. Keep that fight going. As a member of the Foreign Affairs Committee, my pledge to you is to help you any way I can. Please know that you're not alone. We see the plight, we see the problem. I want more of my colleagues to take notice, to get involved. We want to stand in solidarity with y'all. And I apologize. So you have a friend in Randy Weber. Thank you for being here. Keep fighting the good fight. Thank you very much.
Nowruz Mubarak. May this be the year of freedom. May this be the year of new Iran. May this be the year of freedom. May this be the new of Iran. Free Iran! Free Iran! I understand our friends in Iran are watching this live. I say to you, American people want you to be free. We are one people. We both believe in freedom, and we believe in you. Stand up. This time we ask our president, when you rise up, please speak up for the people of Iran. We want freedom. I was so touched when the people of Iran rose up. I put it on my Facebook, the picture of that poor woman bleeding to death. It was so heartbreaking. People want simple things. They don't want elaborate things. They just want to be able to breathe free, to taste the freedom, to see the freedom. And I hope this is the year that Iran will rise up again. And this time, the United States needs to stand with you, both in heart and in words and in deeds. Be with you. I want to wish you all a happy new year. And we join you in your celebrations, and thank you for having me. My door is open to you anytime, and we're going to support anything we can do for you.
God bless you all. We love you. Thank you.
Folks, I know you've had so many good speakers before me, and I don't know what to really add to what they've said, but let me just say to you that all of you give me great hope, because I know that as long as the hope of liberty beats in any one of your hearts, that the people of Camp Ashraf, Camp Liberty, are not forgotten. I know that the people that are oppressed by the existing regime in Iran are not forgotten. And lastly, I just want you to know you give me hope, because I believe that because of your courage, because of your willingness to be here to try to light the fires of freedom in this country and the concern for Iran, I am convinced that someday it won't just be a new year, but it will truly be a new day in Iran when the light of liberty will fall across every lonely face in that country. God bless you all.
Well, thanks, everyone. And, you know, fundamentally, there's one reason that we're here. Freedom and justice. That's the primary reason we're all here. I look forward to continuing our friendship and thinking creatively with you how to restore the proper relationship between the United States and Iran, work toward an Iran that, as well as the Middle East, that is nuclear free, bring about not only a reunion of our peoples, but perhaps a joyous celebration of a newfound relationship. So thank you all for what you're doing.